Good morning. I would like to thank the organizers for invitation for this very special conference, but also the pleasure of being in Pisa again and seeing many old friends. So the topic of my lecture is one very specific memoir of Joseph-Louis Lagrange, although on the topic he has done many other work, but I really wanted to focus because for me it's a very interesting example of actually something which has been also shown by Jean-Luc Chabert on the fact that Lagrange, starting from very concrete problems, can really lift them to a new height, that is, introducing new concepts and without almost doing it, just in passing, but really with a major step, and in this case it's really the birth of a new geometry. So in a sense, I want to, as I started to mention, to really discuss this paper, because it's a mathematical paper that creates two new concepts in one stroke, which is not that frequent. Also, I discovered, because my own reading of this paper, I'm sure historians had this paper very much in mind, but I noticed that it was quoted in a number of books on symplectic geometry, even when I asked the authors of the book whether they had read the paper. They had not read the paper, so I went to to the paper, and then was absolutely I found it absolutely remarkable the way it was written and the content. Actually, to really get hold of it, I had to go to Oberwolfach, because that's the place where you find all the good mathematical papers. I thought I could find it at the École Polytechnique, and it seemed that it was misplaced. Later on, I found it, but not the first time. Anyway, but also it's for me very important, because you know the period, 1808, is a period where people were really challenging the concept of geometry very much. There was still the idea that there was one geometry, Euclidean geometry, not yet non-Euclidean geometry is accepted. And actually what Lagrange develops in this paper, and of course it has been taken further later, is really a new geometric structure, completely new geometry. And again, what's very remarkable, that this new geometric structure emerges from a very specific problem. And this is not that often. And in a sense, I want to contrast this with the approach, which of course was not coming from nothing, but from a whole history in which Euclidean geometry was formed. Because in Euclid's Elements, you start with axioms, which of course are reflections on built knowledge, but a very different way of doing things, and it's really claimed by Euclid and later on by all people who have worked in establishing Euclidean geometry, that you really create something globally as an object. There it's just on the side that you have a new notion coming up. And as you all know, and the title of the text will show it very explicitly, the motivation was celestial mechanics, which has been for mathematicians a fantastic source of inspiration over the centuries, and including Newton, and actually the birth of differential calculus was very much inspired by this. So this was my pretext. So the way I'm going to make my presentation, I'm sorry, knowing the audience, probably my first part I will try to go very quickly, because everybody actually knows what I'm going to talk about, namely the general context of celestial mechanics. I want to describe this new approach by Joseph-Louis Lagrange, and in particular the creation of a new object, mathematical object, which is the space of elliptic motions, which actually is just one example of a much more general notion, which is the space attached to a solution of differential equations. And as a result, the emergence of symplectic geometry. So in a sense, although Joseph-Louis Lagrange was very much interested in celestial mechanics for itself, namely to discuss in particular the solar system and the motion of planets and so on, he definitely introduced into it some very geometric view. And this is why when we, some years ago, we had a seminar at IHES, actually, which was dedicated to these questions. We entitled it La reconquête de la dynamique par la géométrie après Lagrange, meaning that Of course, Lagrange's approach was still very much in the spirit of differential equations and discussing differential equations, but from that point on, a very geometric point of view emerged and has been systematically developed and has become the completely very natural framework of all the context of dynamics. So this during this conference, first of all, I have at least something handwritten from Lagrange, so which is Salut et Fraternité, Lagrange. Anyway, but so these were the people who spoke at this conference, and in particular on the very specific article I'm going to talk about, there is a very detailed article by Charles-Michel Mal, who really rediscusses the whole thing from completely from beginning to end, which I also enjoyed very much during that conference. Okay, so here is the context of celestial mechanics. So as you know, I mean the what is really the very basics for understanding the solar system is really the laws of Kepler's on the, for the motion of planets around the sun. That is the fact that planets move along ellipses around the sun, and one of the focus of the ellipse is really more or less the sun. So of course it's not exactly correct, because as you know, you have to take the center of gravity of the whole system, and you have the sun and the other planets, and really what should be the focus of the ellipse is actually the center of gravity of the system. Well, let's do as if the sun was at the center of gravity. It's just a small change which doesn't affect the discussion I'm going to have. The second law, as you know, is the fact that if you look at the segment which joins the sun and the planet, it sweeps equal areas in equal times. So that's a very, basically it tells you that if you know the ellipse, if you know the position and the ellipse, actually you know the time, because there is this law which determines exactly how the segment sweeps, goes around when the planet moves around, how the at which speed the segment moves. And the final point, final law of Kepler says that there is a very explicit algebraic relation between the length of the large axis of the ellipse and the period. So this relates very much the distance of more or less the average distance of the planet to the sun with the time taken to go around. So these are the Kepler laws. As you know, these laws were not established mathematically, they were established experimentally in a sense, and of course with some discussion for why you had to come along this. And of course one of the subtle elements was to come across ellipses, because these ellipses in the solar system are almost circular, not exactly of course, but they are not really very ellipses with a really big small eccentricity. And so, as you know, I mean, the transformation of these Kepler laws into mathematical, I mean, these are mathematical statements, but to come up with a mathematical model for this was done by Newton in his Principia, which is a very extraordinary text. And actually, the book is really constructed. Newton was not very modest, as you know, and it was really built as Euclid's element. So it really started with definitions. It contained axioms, theorems in a very specific formulation, and also it did contain also applications. So for example, there is a whole part which is dedicated to the system of the world and also the motion of the moon and things like this. So it's a very comprehensive document, and from that point of view it's very remarkable. So this what is really extraordinary in this book by Newton is the fact that it contains really completely new concepts. For example, of course, he was not the only one to define the notion of velocity, but this is really there, very put, not only with definition, but also how to use it. In particular, the concept which is present there and was not definitely present before, and is absolutely critical of his approach to mechanics, is of course the introduction of acceleration, that is the velocity of the velocity, as you know, and of course it required actually mathematically a really new definition, new concept, and creating a new area of mathematics. And so what he does then, he applies this general principle, the motion of bodies, and that's the way he comes up with his own approach to really the motion of planets around the Sun. And so what is really remarkable is that the model proposed by Newton reproduces the Kepler laws in a deductive fashion because of the fundamental law of dynamics that he proposes, namely that the force should be equal to the acceleration multiplied by the inertial mass. And also he proposes a specific form if you want to solve this equation, you of course need to know what is the force, and the force that he proposes in the case of a gravitational interaction is the well-known force in 1 over the distance squared, which derives, it comes from a potential in 1 over the distance. And so this is a typical drawing that you find, and he's explaining how the bodies are moving along ellipses, and he just describes the laws with the Sun is of course S over there, and then you have the position of the planet, which is denoted by P. So you have P, you have the Sun, and then he's looking at the motion, and that's the proposition in which he discusses all this. So of course the key point is that you find again exactly Kepler's laws in a formulation which comes from a mathematical model, starting from a very general principle about the fundamental law of mechanics and the very specific form of attraction of masses. And so in a sense you get the elliptic trajectory as a solution of a very, very explicit mathematical problem. And actually it's interesting to see them appear in a form which is not so usual if you think of Euclidean geometry. In Euclidean geometry, really, ellipses come up naturally with the two foci and just taking the sum of distance to the two foci being constant, and that's the way you get the ellipses. Here, actually, only one of the foci is playing a role, the other one is something else, and there are good reasons for this, because there are other definitions of ellipses that actually are based only on one foci, but it's interesting to see this very geometric figure coming up in this context. Anyway, so this is so he's talking about the virium is the force, which is centripete, and then he's discussing this approximation by small variations and so on. So of course, as you know, this very idealistic view of the solar system is incorrect, because what is very nice and very can be described very explicitly in mathematical terms is the case of two bodies, namely the Sun and one planet. Of course, the solar system is not just the Sun and one planet, you have also other planets. And therefore, if you are serious about the interaction between bodies of a certain mass, of course, the presence of the extra bodies, the other planets, of course, deform the motion of the planet, and therefore, you cannot just apply this very fantastically explicit model. You have to take into account the effect of the other planets. And of course, the planets are much lighter than the Sun, so you can view this as a perturbation of the initial problem. And this is the method which has been used consistently since Newton to discuss, which is the so-called method of perturbations. There have been all kinds of expansions which are done from the exact solution for two bodies. And of course, a lot of work has been dedicated to this in the after Newton, in particular in the 18th century, with a lot of ingenuity and sophistication from the mathematical point of view. And so now the key point for Lagrange is to look at this problem from a completely different approach. So this is the point of the memoir I mentioned, and that's I want to discuss now. So, as I said, the theory of perturbation has really brought quite some success, But one of the very key questions which has been still floating around was to decide whether really due to conjugation of effects on planets, some of the planets may really evade from the solar system. So that is the length of the greatest axis of one of the ellipses under the influence of the others may start to grow and to grow indefinitely. That is, the planet will be expelled, in a sense, from the solar system. So this has been really something that people were concerned about. And of course, all these discussions on celestial mechanics has been very, very instrumental in Lagrange's thinking about mechanics analytics and so on. But I want to talk about this very specific memoir. And I like it very much because the way it's defined, although Lagrange makes this remark just as a side remark, but if you take it seriously, you realize that, to my knowledge, up to a comment I'm going to make in a minute, the way he proposes to work is really the creation of a totally new space, which I think is the first abstract space which appeared in mathematics. So from that point of view, it's an unbelievable creation. So here is the memoir I'm talking about. So as it is stated, it was presented in 1808 at the French Academy. And so, memoir sur la théorie des variations des éléments des planètes. I'm going to redefine what are éléments des planètes in a minute. En particulier des variations des grands axes dans leurs orbites. So this is directly related to the discussion I made about the fact that one of the worries was, can you control the size of the largest axis, namely, can a planet get out of the solar system? This is one of the key questions which has been coming again and again. So here is the way the article starts. So maybe I stick to French, if you don't mind. I don't translate like this. So on entend en astronomie par élément d'une planète les quantités qui déterminent son orbite autour du Soleil, supposée elliptique, ainsi que le lieu de la planète dans un instant marqué qu'on appelle l'époque. Ces quantités sont au nombre de 5, dont 2, le grand axe, donc quand il parle du grand axe, c'est la longueur du grand axe, et la distance moyenne qui en est la moitié, et l'excentricité détermine la grandeur de l'ellipse dont le Soleil occupe un des foyers. Les 3 autres, la longitude de l'aphélie, celle des nœuds et l'inclinaison, détermine la position du grand axe sur le plan de l'ellipse et la position de ce plan sur un plan qu'on regarde comme fixe par rapport aux étoiles. Ces 5 quantités, jointes à l'époque, étant connues pour une planète, on peut trouver en tout temps son lieu dans le ciel. So here he states, par le moyen de ces 2 lois découvertes par Kepler, que les aires décrites dans l'ellipse par rayon vecteur croissent proportionnellement au temps et que la durée de la révolution est proportionnelle à la racine carrée du cube du grand axe. This was the algebraic relation I referred to. Okay, so what he says very explicitly is that to know the position of a planet, you need 6 constants, namely the 5 which fix the ellipse, and then, since you know the law of time along the ellipse, either the position on the ellipse or the time is equivalent, that's what he called l'époque. So with this, you have a problem with 6 parameters. That's the main statement that he makes. And so this is the way the article starts. And then he goes on like this. Maybe it's... So, ici, I'm starting here again. Ce n'est que par l'observation qu'on peut trouver les valeurs des éléments d'une planète, mais il faut beaucoup d'art pour les déduire des lieux observés. Ce travail occupe les astronomes depuis Kepler, car comme la précision des éléments dépend de celle des observations, de nouvelles observations plus exactes amènent toujours des corrections aux éléments qu'on avait déterminés. Lorsque, dans le siècle dernier, on entreprit d'appliquer le calcul différentiel, Newton, à la solution des problèmes que Newton avait résolus par des constructions linéaires, on reconnut que le mouvement d'une planète attirée par le Soleil, en raison inverse du carré de la distance, dépend de 3 équations différentielles du second ordre, qui demandent par conséquent 6 intégrations. Parce que c'est 3 équations du second ordre. Ces intégrations introduisent chacune le calcul d'une constante arbitraire, de sorte que la solution du problème renferme, en dernière analyse, 6 constantes arbitraires. Ce sont les éléments mêmes de la planète ou des fonctions de ces éléments. So again, he discusses connecting to Newton's law, of course, and the form the very specific form of Newton's law, namely linear differential equations of second order, and three of them because you are in three-dimensional space. You have also these six constants, and actually you have a dictionary that is a diffeomorphism, if you want, between these six constants. So this is his discussion. And so now he is starting to, at that time he was just discussing the general problem. Mais les planètes ne sont pas seulement attirées par le Soleil, elles s'attirent encore mutuellement, et l'effet de cette action mutuelle est de déranger leur mouvement elliptique et d'y produire des inégalités qu'on nomme perturbations, dont le calcul est long et délicat et fait depuis Newton l'objet des travaux des géomètres. At this time, geometry meant only mathematicians. I mean, it was nothing to do with geometry in a present sense, qui s'occupe de la théorie du système du monde. En effet, les forces qui résultent de cette dernière attraction ajoutent aux équations différentielles de leur mouvement des termes qui en rendent l'intégration impossible dans l'état actuel de l'analyse, et comme on sait depuis impossible tout court, au sens de l'intégration complète, et qui forcent de recourir aux approximations. Heureusement, ces termes sont très petits vis-à-vis de ceux qui viennent de l'action directe du Soleil, parce qu'ils sont multipliés par les masses mêmes des planètes, ou plutôt par leur rapport à celle du Soleil. Et si l'on intègre les équations différentielles comme s'ils n'existaient pas, il arrive que les constantes arbitraires que l'intégration ajoute à chaque intégrale se trouvent augmentées d'une petite partie variable due à ces mêmes masses. Donc, just repeating in his own terms, which I find remarkably transparent and easy to read, it's a very nice text. So, so that was just a continuation due à ces mêmes terme dont on ne peut à la vérité trouver la valeur finie et rigoureuse parce qu'elle dépend d'une intégration qui est impossible, that is solving the partial, the differential equation with the extra term which one does know how to do, en général, mais dont on peut avoir par des approximations successives la valeur aussi approchée qu'on voudra. Ainsi, les éléments du mouvement elliptique, qui par l'action seule du Soleil sont constants, deviennent sujets à de petites variations. Et quoique, à la rigueur, le mouvement ne soit plus elliptique, on peut néanmoins le regarder comme tel à chaque instant. L'ellipse variable devient alors osculatrice de la véritable orbite de la planète. Donc, here is the very basic idea. That is, instead of working in the ordinary three-dimensional space, or if you prefer, in the six-dimensional extension, position and velocities, six-dimensional space, he says, I'm going to work in a different space, which is the space of elliptic motions, and the true motion will be seen as a motion in the space of elliptic motions, and the way you get the trajectory in the space of elliptic motion will be to look at, as he says, the variable ellipse will become osculating to the true orbit of the planet. So here is the, in passing, the big jump, which is to say, I'm leaving the ordinary space and it's the usual way of formulating the Newton's equation by saying I'm going to move in a different space. And why do I do that? Because if I only consider the Sun and one planet, actually that's no motion. Because in the space of elliptic motion, if there is no distortion by the other planet, actually you stand still because you are in a very well-defined elliptic motion. But of course, because there is the other planet, you are moving from one elliptic motion to another one, which of course in true space means you're not anymore on an ellipse, but the way you get. So this is the transfer which is done in passing, which is actually a very extraordinary thing. So for me, I think historically that's really the first instance where one goes from a very natural normal space, which is three-dimensional space or six-dimensional space if I add the components of the velocities, to something which is some kind of an unknown territory, which is the space of elliptic motion. There will be another step. I mentioned that what is the breakthroughs in this paper, there are two. There are this notion, and then the realization by Lagrange that this space of elliptic motion, comes up with a very well-defined mathematical structure, which is, of course, at this moment not visible. It will come later. Anyway, so so he goes on to say, so actually he connects this with what he calls, he goes on by saying that, comme on peut le conclure de la théorie générale de l'osculation que j'ai exposée ailleurs et qui est fondée sur la variation des constantes. So for him he relates this immediately to his own theory of differential equations and in particular the method of variations of constants that he had been using previously. C'est de cette manière que j'ai considéré et calculé les variations des éléments des planètes dans la théorie de ces variations que j'ai donnée dans le mémoire des années 1781, 1782 et suivantes. À part que, quand on va regarder ces mémoires, il n'y a pas du tout cette idée-là géométrique de changer d'espace. Évidemment, peut-être dans sa tête, c'était déjà là, mais en tout cas, à ce moment-là, c'est purement un calcul analytique. It's only an analytic computation, it's not at all a conceptual approach. Anyway, so now he's formulating, that's the end of the introduction, what he wants to do in this mémoire. L'objet de ce mémoire est d'exposer les nouvelles formules que j'ai trouvées pour les variations des éléments des planètes, ainsi que leur application aux variations des grands axes. So he's still obsessed by this question of having a planet getting out of the system, et de développer surtout l'analyse qui m'y a conduit, et qui me paraît mériter l'attention des géomètres par son uniformité et par ses généralités, puisqu'elle est indépendante de la considération des orbites elliptiques, et qu'elle peut s'appliquer avec le même succès à toute autre hypothèse de gravitation dans lesquelles les orbites ne seraient plus des sections cubiques. So he realizes that actually it's connected to a very general phenomenon, connected to differential equations, and even if the force is not the same force as the one one is usually having for a gravitational attraction, you can actually still develop the similar consideration. Okay, so for me, from now on, I'm interested in the space of elliptic motions, because that's the space in which Lagrange suggests that we work in R3. And as he mentions again in passing, this is just a special case of the space of motion attached to a differential equation, as he mentioned. Of course, this very general notion has been really developed quite systematically by Jean-Marie Souriau. Actually, the next stage, which is invisible at this moment, but will later on be absolutely fundamental, is that this space of elliptic motion is not just a space with six dimensions, but also actually a structured space. Namely, it has really an internal structure which leads to a new geometry. So, and of course, this doesn't happen in all cases. It happens when the dynamics has a special property, which is that one can express only in this geometry itself, so it's kind of a self-inducing process, and which then allows the formulation of dynamics in radically new terms. So I'm going to discuss that later on. So actually, on this topic, Lagrange published two memoirs following up, 1809-1810, so the next one, which is a complement to this one, is called Sur la théorie générale de la variation des constantes arbitraires dans tous les problèmes de mécanique, which of course is connected to what he says about the generality of the process. And then the next one, 1810, which is a second mémoire sur la théorie de la variation des constantes arbitraires dans les problèmes de mécanique. So this completes, of course, this. But of course, the 1808 memoir is the one where really the conceptual jump is made. So let me discuss a little bit the space of elliptic motions. So I'm going to start with something different, which could be considered actually as the birth of this first abstract space in mathematics, which is actually the space of rotation in R3. So as you know, what is a rotation in R3? It's trivial to say that it's transformed vectors into vectors, and it preserves their scalar product, it preserves orientation. And as you know, every rotation in R3 has an axis and an angle, and you can really write as a matrix with a, if you choose the basis properly, which is the angle is theta, and I've chosen the last vector of the basis of R3 to be the axis of the rotation. And any rotation is connected to the identity through a natural path, which actually shows it's a you can view this as the exponential of some very well-defined matrix. Okay, so the object, before going to the space of elliptic motions, I'm going to concentrate on the space of rotation in R3 as a preliminary step for the understanding of the space of ellipses. And then after ellipses, I will go to elliptic motions, of course. So how does there are many ways of understanding the space of rotation. So, as I mentioned, maybe the first abstract space was actually the space of rotation due to Euler. And but you can also think of it as a space of matrices. I'm going to say one thing, because if you want to understand globally the group of rotations. There is a very nice geometric construction, which I'm going to give because it's very brief. And of course, it's probably the most efficient way was done by Hamilton. And it's even the way one really, if you want to code a rotation in a computer, that's the way it's used, in using quaternions. That's the most efficient way. Anyway, so Euler angles is very well known. So I give myself a frame in R3. So three axes, orthogonal axes. And of course, giving a rotation is just to tell what happens to this orthogonal frame when it's moved. So I give myself a new frame, O, X prime, Y prime, Z prime. And then I want to relate the first frame to the second frame. So what do you do? Well, using the first frame, you define a plane, which is the plane O, X, Y. And then you also have the similar plane, O, X prime, Y prime. Then, of course, these two planes, in general, have an intersection. So this is the so-called nodal line, which is the line of intersection of the two planes. And the first Euler angle is just the angle between lines. It's not an angle between vectors, so defined between 0 and pi, which is psi. And then, of course, next thing you do is you can, now you have these two planes, the black plane and the yellow plane. And then, of course, they are normals, which are OZ and OZ prime. And then the second Euler angle is the angle between OZ and OZ prime. And then now I need to move to get, so in a sense, I've already done some transformation from OXYZ to O, I moved at least to Z prime. So now the last angle, Euler angle, is the angle between the nodal line and the X prime. So with these three angles, you specify completely the position of the frame, the new frame with respect to the previous frame. And so these three angles determine the rotation. Of course, I've been slightly sloppy because I said the two planes intersect, for example. So the nodal line is defined provided the planes are different. But if the planes are the same, you need to do something, which is not completely obvious because some of the elements of my construction are undetermined. So it means even if you are very careful about the intervals in which the angles psi, phi, and theta vary, which are not the same, psi and theta are angles between lines. Phi is an angle between vectors. So one is determined up to 2 pi, the other one is determined up to pi. But even if you do that, you still have some degeneracies. So in a sense, locally, you can describe the rotations, but you don't really get the global picture of the space of rotation. And so there is a geometric construction which is very well known, very elementary, which gives you a global picture of the space of rotation. So again, I'm starting from my situation where I have a point M, which is moved by a rotation of axis V and angle theta to a point M prime. So this is a typical rotation determined by an axis, which is a certain vector, and an angle theta. Now I can represent the rotation by the following construction. If I put the point which is with a coordinate tangent theta over 2 on the axis, oriented by V, I can, in a sense, attach to every rotation, axis V, angle theta, this point in 3 space, tangent theta over 2, which is on along the axis determined by V. And of course, the key remark I make, of course, when I said I take the axis V, I could have taken minus V as well, the axis. But then, of course, my angle theta, it becomes minus theta. And my construction, which is to represent my rotation by tangent theta over 2 times V, of course, if I replace V and theta by minus V minus theta, it gives the same point. So the ambiguity, which was between choosing V and minus V, actually doesn't affect my representing the rotation by this point in 3 space. And now the key point is, of course, now, the key point is what happens, of course, when theta equals pi. Pi over 2, tangent pi over 2 is infinity. So I need to know what I've been doing with this rotation. So let me, why is this construction interesting? Well, first, any point of R3 corresponds to a rotation, because there is always, you can reach all points by tangent theta over 2 along an axis. The symmetry around the axis corresponds to the point infinity in the axis direction, which means when I go to infinity in one direction, if I go to infinity in the other direction, it's the same point. So it means that the group of rotation is exactly the compactification of R3 without making difference between going this way or this way, which is exactly real projective space. So this approach gives you not only a description of a group of rotation, but also it gives you a global view of rotation. If you want to do this with Euler, with the Euler angles, it's much more difficult to catch what is the global structure. Actually, you can do it, but it's painful. Anyway, there's still a weak point in this construction. That's why the Hamilton's construction is so nice. Is if you want to multiply rotation with this construction, it's actually very painful. Of course, with quaternions, it's completely trivial because you're really in a context where you can compute things. Okay, so that was, in a sense, a side remark. So now, I'm interested in the space of ellipses in R3, and I will use my discussion of rotations for this. And of course, all my ellipses will be ellipses with one focus at the origin, and that's my normalization with respect to the sun. And so my ellipse lies in a plane in R3. So how do I describe, so it lies in the plane. So I will later on discuss the position of the plane in three space. But for the moment, in the plane, if I want to specify the ellipse, I need the length of the major axis and I need the eccentricity, typically. So, and of course, now I need the angle of the major axis with the fixed direction in the plane R2. So with these three elements, I can definitely determine the ellipse in a given plane. So now I need a bit more. So now I have to determine what is the plane R2 sitting in R3. And again, this requires actually to locate, and I'm back to my construction using the nodal line, because I can take a fixed plane in R3, and then I look at the intersection between the fixed plane and the plane R2 in which the ellipse is lying. And so this gives me a line, and then I have to say how this line fits with respect to the fixed direction, which I mentioned in my plane R2. Okay. So from my discussion from rotation, I can really come up with the idea that the space of ellipses in R3 requires five parameters: the length of the major axis, the eccentricity, the angle of the major axis with the fixed direction, and then to specify the position of R2 with respect to a fixed R2 in R3, then is again requires two parameters. Okay, so with these five parameters, I can describe all ellipses in R3. My point is that I'm not interested only in the ellipses, I'm interested in elliptic motions. But again, that was my comment on the position of the plane. And so now you need the angle along the ellipse, because of the law of areas of Kepler, this gives you the time. Okay, so five parameters for ellipse to describe ellipses with a fixed focus in R3, and then one more parameter to get where you are on the ellipse from the law of areas due to Kepler. Okay, so remember I'm repeating something I already showed you, namely the discussion by Lagrange in his paper of the five parameters plus the epoch, as he says. So these are the six parameters. So now, how is the next stage is, of course, from my space of elliptic motions to get to, which is a six-dimensional space, which is the space in which the new problem will be set in a new formulation, which is, what is this new structure? So here is what Lagrange says in his paper. Comme l'effet de l'action des planètes perturbatrices est contenu dans la fonction oméga, en rejetant les termes qui en dépendent, on a, pour le mouvement de la planète M, en tant qu'elle n'est attirée que par le Soleil, les trois équations. So he's putting in a separate term all effects of planets on planets, forgetting about the action of the Sun. So the main action will be the action of the Sun. Of course, he has normalized the mass of the Sun to be one. So, les intégrales de ces équations sont assez connues et donnent une ellipse décrite suivant les lois de Kepler, mais nous n'en avons pas besoin ici, il suffit pour notre objet de faire les remarques suivantes. Que les valeurs des coordonnées sont des fonctions du temps et des six constantes arbitraires introduites par les six intégrations que nous désignerons par A, B, C, F, G, H. Elles déterminent la grandeur et la position de l'ellipse sur le plan de projection. ainsi que le lieu de la planète dans un instant donné. Et on nomme en astronomie élément de la planète. Que, si l'on dénote par 2A, le grand axe de l'orbite elliptique de la planète M, en sorte que A soit la distance moyenne, son mouvement moyen, qui est proportionnel au temps, sera exprimé par NT en faisant la formule qui est là. Et que les coordonnées X, Y, Z pourront être exprimées en série de sinus et cosinus d'angles multiples de NT, dont les coefficients seront des fonctions données des éléments A, B, T, A, B, etc. Donc l'élément important pour lui, c'est toujours de spécifier que si on veut revenir... I'm sorry. Important for him is when one wants to come back to the normal formulation using X, Y, T and the velocities with respect to X, to Y and Z. Actually, it's always possible. That is, there is really, if you know the constants A, B, C, F, G, H, and you want to study the movement with respect, with using T as variable to denote the time, then you can actually come back always from this A, B, C, F, G, H to the true coordinates and the ordinary space. So that's the key point. Okay, so now, so that was the main thing. So if you start forgetting about the rest, you have the ellipse, and you know there is a dictionary between the constant of motions and the position of the ellipse. Considérons maintenant les perturbations dues à l'action des autres planètes, qui introduit dans les équations les termes dépendants de la fonction oméga. Pour avoir égard à ces termes, la méthode la plus simple est celle de la variation des constantes arbitraires que j'ai employée depuis longtemps. Suivant les principes de cette méthode, que j'ai exposée de matière générale dans les mémoires de l'Académie de Berlin 1775, comme les équations différentielles auxquelles il s'agit de satisfaire sont du second ordre, on conservera les expressions elliptiques des coordonnées x, y, z, ainsi que celles des différentielles vitesse. Mais en y regardant les constantes ABC comme variables, et on vérifiera les équations par la variation de ces constantes dans les différentielles secondes. Alors, c'est là que commence le calcul. Peut-être je ne vais pas avoir le temps de le décrire complètement, mais on commence quand même par ce qu'il dit là. Désignons pour un moment par la caractéristique delta les différentielles provenant de la variation des constantes, tandis que la caractéristique ordinaire d se rapporte à la variation de t. La différence première de x aura pour valeur complète, en faisant tout varier, dx, qui est dû à la variation par rapport à t, plus delta x, qui est dû à la variation des constantes. Donc supposant delta x égale 0, elle sera simplement dx. Ainsi, la valeur complète de la différence seconde de x sera d dx plus delta dx. Donc ça, il parle cette fois différence seconde, c'est quand il s'intéresse donc aux variations des vitesses. Mais la partie d dx satisfait à l'équation en x sans le terme d oméga sur dx et on forme le second membre. Donc ça, il revient aux équations d'avant, quelles que soient les valeurs des constantes, puisque l'équation se vérifie identiquement. Donc l'autre partie doit vérifier, puisqu'il a séparé les deux parties, le reste de l'équation, ainsi l'on aura delta dx sur dt carré égale d oméga sur dx. De sorte que relativement à l'équation en x, on aura par la variation des constantes arbitraires les deux équations, delta x égale 0 et delta dx sur dt carré égale d oméga sur dx. On aura de même relativement à l'équation en y, etc., et l'équation en z. Voilà. Les deux équations, voilà. Heureusement, j'ai trouvé une combinaison de ces deux équations qui conduit à des résultats simples et très remarquables que je vais exposer. Donc c'est là que commence le... So Lagrange establishes the differential equations satisfied by these functions and discovered that they have a very simple form when expressed using quantity that he denotes by this kind of a parenthesis. And so today, these parentheses are called Lagrange brackets. Actually, the simplest form for this parenthesis is not given in this memoir, but in a later memoir. And from this formula, it's very clear, I'm going to show it in a minute, XAB depends on the choice of a full coordinate system, that is the ABC, FGH, which have actually a very special property. So you see, here he's describing what he's doing with his equation. So he said, he starts from the first equation, multiplied by something, je retranche la première équation multipliée par ceci, de la seconde multipliée par dx. So, j'ai, he has a certain computation, where here on this side he has some quantities with dt, and here he has db, dc, df, dg, dh. And therefore, Well, he says that he has this, provided that he defines capital A, capital B, capital C, capital D, capital E, being these expressions. So dx over dA, d2x over dt dB, minus, and so on. And so, mais pour mieux conserver la signification de ces formules, nous emploierons à la place des lettres A, B, C, les symboles XAB, XAC, XAF. Ainsi, l'expression qu'il donne ici sera représentée par XBA, parce qu'elle ne diffère de celle de grand A que par l'échange des lettres A et B. So this one was called XAB, so it's normal that he calls this one XBA. Et comme elle est égale à moins A, il s'ensuit que l'on aura XBA égale moins XAB. Donc en général, l'échange des lettres qui suivent la lettre X ne fera que rendre la quantité régulière et l'on a ainsi que XAA égale 0, à cause de l'antisymétrie qu'il a montré là. De cette manière, so just repeating from what he had said before, he obtains the formula for dx over dA, d omega over dx, dx over dA, dt. So he has this, dB, dc, df, dg, dh, that is all the differentials but dA, with a coefficient which contains A with B, A with C, A with F, A with G, A with H. Les mêmes équations étant multipliées la seconde par dx sur dB, la première par d2x sur dt dB, et ensuite retranchées de l'autre. So he goes on with the same calculation than here, with now he had B, A, here he has B, and of course he gets, so instead of writing x, B, A here, dA, he writes, he still keeps this term, but he uses the anti-symmetry. Équation que l'on peut déduire immédiatement de la précédente par l'échange des lettres A et B entre elles et en se souvenant de ça. Par le même procédé, on aura ce qui se déduit ainsi de la, aussi de la première en échangeant A en C et C en A. Continuant ainsi, on aura encore trois autres équations qu'on pourra déduire successivement de la première en y échangeant A en F, en G, en H et vice-versa. So it gives the final formulas. On aura de pareilles équations pour les valeurs dωa sur dωa sur dy, dy sur dA, etc. Et pour cela, il nous faudra changer dans les précédentes x en y, et l'on aura encore de pareil pour les termes en z. Maintenant, si on ajoute ensemble les valeurs de dωa sur dx, dx sur dA, dωa sur dy sur dA, dωa sur dz, dz sur dA, et que l'on se rappelle que ωa n'est fonction que de x, y, z, x', y', z', et que les constantes A, B, C, F, G, H ne sont contenues que dans x, y, z, il est visible que l'on aura dωa sur dA, faisant apparaître seulement trois termes qui font intervenir la dépendance d'oméga par rapport à x, y et z. Et par conséquent, quand il réécrit le terme dωa sur dA dt, en souvenant des expressions qu'il a trouvées pour tout ça, qu'il a donné avant, il fait apparaître ça uniquement avec ces fameux crochets de Lagrange. D'accord ? Pour avoir les valeurs des coefficients dans cette équation, il faudra substituer dans les expressions de, voilà, les valeurs elliptiques de x, y, z en t, etc., et exécuter les différenciations partielles relatives à ces quantités. Et il est facile de voir qu'on aura pour les coefficients dont il s'agit les mêmes fonctions des quantités t, a, b, c, f, g, h, soit que les six dernières soient supposées variables ou constantes. En les supposant constantes, les valeurs de x, y satisfont aux équations de Newton, qu'il a déjà rappelées, quelles que soient ces constantes, puisqu'elles sont arbitraires. Donc les mêmes équations sont encore satisfaites si l'on donne à une de ces constantes, comme A, l'accroissement infiniment petit et constant delta A. Or, il est clair que les accroissements correspondants de x, y, z seront donnés par la dépendance de x, y, z par rapport à A, et ces valeurs devront par conséquent satisfaire aux équations précédentes différenciées suivant la caractéristique delta, pas D. Pour simplifier ces différenciations, je mets les équations dont il s'agit sous cette forme plus simple et équivalente. Donc il réécrit l'équation de Newton ici en faisant apparaître la différentielle du potentiel. Et alors, dénotons, donc là, il introduit vraiment les parenthèses de Lagrange, les crochets de Lagrange. So here he introduces the symbols which are the Lagrange brackets. So he just repeats the expression. And so now the very key fact that he quotes is, en procédant de la même manière, après avoir ajouté ensemble les trois quantités, dont la somme est égale à ceci, et fait les opérations analogues, il trouve aussi la formule, ça c'était pour A, il trouve la formule pour B. So the very key point here is that dωa over dA dt is equal to this expression using only Lagrange brackets, So now he has freed himself from the presence of the specific variables x, y, z, and so on. And so the key point, so he knows the explicit the value for the quantities which are the Lagrange brackets. And the key point that now he chooses to have the time disappear by using the substitution. And then, et on voit que cette formule peut se déduire de la précédente en échangeant entre elles les quantités A et B, en just using skew symmetry. On aura donc ainsi les quatre formules correspondantes. I'm sorry, these are equal sign. My photocopy is not good quality, so these are equal sign. And so he has d omega over dc dt, d omega over df, so giving the other one. Il est bien remarquable que les différences partielles de la fonction oméga, relatives aux constantes arbitraires, puissent s'exprimer ainsi par des fonctions différentielles de ces mêmes constantes sans que le temps t y entre. Il s'ensuit qu'on pourra également exprimer les différentielles par les différences partielles de la fonction oméga relatives aux éléments ABC, multipliées par de simples fonctions de ces quantités sans t. So the key point here is that he says that the variation in time will first it comments on the fact that the partial partial derivatives of omega with respect to the six the parameters in the space of elliptic motions can be expressed by differential function without t entering, and he says that from this formula you can actually invert it and actually obtain that these dA dt dB dt dC dt can be obtained from omega. From differential partial derivatives of omega with respect to a, b, c, and so on. So this is the crucial step where he has discovered actually what one would call today the symplectic structure, which is the fact that the evolution of the parameters are governed by the partial derivative of omega with respect to the position in the space of elliptic motions. And so he gives the form for those. And he says that all the coefficients which appear here are strictly given by the Lagrange brackets. And therefore, ne seront par conséquent que de simples fonctions des éléments sans t, ce qui fournit un théorème très important et très utile dans la théorie des perturbations des planètes. So that's the very key fact that from the geometry of the space of elliptic motions, you get the evolution in time of the various parameters. Which of course now we know very well, it's expressing the dynamics strictly in terms of what one calls now Poisson brackets using the perturbation function omega. So this is, of course, this relies on something which he discusses later on. I think I'll skip it because it becomes a bit too tedious to read the document fully. Of course, the key fact is that the coordinates he has chosen are actually so-called Darboux coordinates. That is, if you write what one would write now the symplectic form, in these coordinates it has a diagonal form, it's in the standard form. And actually he discusses this center.
Sorry, but it may just be ignorance on my part. But I thought most of these concepts actually arose in Hamilton's work. That is the Hamiltonian form.
Yeah, but that's much later.
I mean, exactly. So,
that's 1808. Hamilton is 1837, 40, and so on.
You really are telling me that.
Just for the record.
So you really are telling me that the concepts which in most textbooks nowadays are called Hamiltonian formalism, Hamiltonian concepts, and so forth, actually appeared
Absolutely.
Already in Lagrange.
That's why I consider the paper important, because that's the birth of symplectic geometry. It's not Hamilton; it's 30 years before.
Okay, thank you.
That's the point. That's the point.
Well. There's no Hamiltonian there. It's all Lagrange. He doesn't write a Hamiltonian.
Except that he writes Hamilton's equations.
But
where is the dual variable?
Sorry?
It's all second order. Excuse me. Where is
No, that's what I just said.
I understand.
So you missed
sure.
it. Which is to say that it's exactly this formulation. The evolution of the position in the space of elliptic motion in time.
Yes.
It's given by the Lagrange brackets using the function omega,
yeah.
which is a first-order equation. It's not a second-order equation.
Yeah, I understand this, but...
But that's Hamilton's equation. It is. No, it's... That's the point. That's the point. So, but it's true that he does it in passing. He doesn't start. I mean, the formalism is implicit. It's not explicit. Although, as he says before, he says that that this furnishes a very important theorem, which is extremely useful in the theory of perturbation. So he realizes the importance, but doesn't state it as a as Hamilton would do it in a quite complete way and as a systematic system. He just adapts it to this equation. Okay, so actually, Poisson takes this up in a memoir just the year after that, and Poisson was actually a student of Lagrange at Ecole Polytechnique, and actually introduces a formulation which is even more direct. The connection between the two is actually what one now uses as Poisson brackets, and actually the expression of the Lagrange brackets are more or less the matrix which is the inverse of the Poisson brackets if you express them in local coordinates. So it has to do with whether you're working on the tangent space or the cotangent space, and in this setting where you have a nice Legendre transformation between the two. And actually the formulation which is even clearer even before Hamilton is due to Cauchy in a memoir which was actually read at the Academy in, I think, 1831, but published in the Journal de Liouville in 1837, which is called Notes sur la variation des constantes arbitraires dans les problèmes de mécanique, which actually takes up the development by Lagrange and by Poisson. And so, as you know, I mean, this new geometry was developed further by Hamilton, as you suggested, I mean, which is well known, and now we tend to call it really Hamiltonian geometry. Of course, Hamilton is much more systematic and has a much much more, it's not, in a sense, the presentation seems to be, besides the comment that you can generalize it, which is meant in the introduction, all the development is for this very specific problem, which is the problem of celestial mechanics, with the very specific parameters on the space of elliptic motions, which happen to be very nice coordinates. They are symplectic coordinates. But clearly, in the minds of Lagrange, he has completely understood what is behind it. And of course, as you know, I mean, a very important step was taken by Darboux, who showed that symplectic geometry is locally trivial. That is, all any symplectic structure can be locally reduced to symplectic form in a diagonal form. And of course, many others have developed this geometry over the years. But still, at this stage in the 19th century, we're still considering symplectic geometry locally. That is, nobody thought about the global structure of symplectic geometry. So as you know, a lot of work has been dedicated in the 20th century to a global question. That is, in the same way as looking locally at the group of rotation, Euler angles are perfect. If you want to understand globally the group of rotation, you better have other tools. In the same way for symplectic geometry, some names need to be mentioned. Actually, Souriot is one of the persons who really understood symplectic geometry for the purpose of physics and mechanics, and considered really global questions. The first person actually who pointed to global non-triviality of symplectic geometry is Eugenio Calabi, in a very remarkable paper, just one paper on this subject by him at a certain moment. And probably the person who really made the big jump was Michel Gromov, who introduced very efficient methods to deal with global problems in symplectic geometry, the so-called quasi-holomorphic curves and things like this. And now symplectic geometry has become even symplectic topology. That is, people use symplectic concept to discuss very global question, including questions pertinent for quantum physics and modern physics. Thank you very much.
When the name symplectic geometry was introduced?
I think it was introduced by Hermann Weyl, 1912 or something like this. Actually, he was looking for an expression which would mean complex, Naturally, would have thought of calling complex geometry, but then complex meant something else because of complex numbers. So it just went to the Greek source of complex and used symplectic. So I think it's Hermann Weyl who coined the expression. And I think the date is 1911 or 1912. I would have to check again.
Okay, two things. First of all, we can continue the discussion later. But this is Poisson brackets. This is not the one form. So in other words, I still think it's not the Hamiltonian formalism. It's the Poisson formalism. So we can discuss that.
But it's not the second order equation.
It's not the second order. I agree with that. But it's Poisson. It's a Poisson formalism. It's not the one form. Now, just since we're in Italy, I would like to mention that the space you're considering of elliptic motion, thanks to the transformation of Levi-Civita, is exactly the same thing as a space of harmonic motions. And it's a pendulum. And I think this method, once you've done that, Levi-Civita and Moser have used that for the theory of perturbation in celestial mechanics. You have.
Actually, one thing I didn't say, I could have said at the end, is if you look at, in a sense, what Lagrange was considering, it was strictly among the possible motion for a planet, the fact that it would be an ellipse. But actually, you should also consider other motions, which could be, I'm talking about planets, but you can think of other celestial bodies, which some of them have a hyperbolic motion and some of them a parabolic motion. So if you, as soon as you do such a, consider such objects, you actually, the space of motions, which I cannot call it any more elliptic motion, because they can be several families, become singular. And how do you get over this singularity? Actually, you use the so-called Levi-Civita regularization, because even if you have this singularity, if you do it in the right way, make the right change of variables, actually you can desingularize the space and have a proper discussion of that space. So actually, the Levi-Civita was one who really did discussion. And another work which was very interesting in terms of desingularization of motion was due to Constant Anaimo and Stifel, which in the same spirit as the... So in a sense, what Levi-Civita was using is very much connected to taking a branch cover in complex analysis. And what Constant Anaimo and Stifel did was doing some kind of a similar construction with quaternions, which actually is very interesting from the quantum point of view. So quantum physicists have been using this regularization by Constant Anaimo and Stifel. So this idea that the space, if you want to consider it globally, as singularities has also led to very interesting work late on. But again, with a point of view of being global. So if you stick to a local, around a motion, looking around it, I mean, you have a specific type of motions. And so you can strictly work with elliptic motion. If you really want to consider globally any kind of body which moves around the sun, then you need to look at all possible motions, which of course leads to a more complicated space.
I'm questioning a little bit your word. I don't know whether I recall it precisely, that what Hamilton did was a further development of Lagrange, because Hamilton came from geometrical optics and he had a completely different point of view. And only
So maybe my formulation was, I think it was just the new geometry was developed further. So. I didn't mean that Hamilton was following
Hamilton
the same path.
Hamilton was completely
I agree. So I just meant about the geometry itself. In a sense, Hamilton arrived at the geometry from completely different point of view, actually. So, yeah, so maybe my formulation is ambiguous. I didn't mean at all that he was... I started my lecture by saying that Lagrange came to this with the really celestial mechanics and even the motion, planetary motion in mind, which was in a sense a very narrow way of looking at this question. And you can come to symplectic geometry with many other inputs, and that's actually what Hamilton did, for sure. So I think what I wrote is still ambiguous enough that your criticism, I can stand it. But you're right, you're absolutely right.
Just to mention, which transformation by Levi-Civita, what was mentioned by Ivar Eklund. It appeared in a paper by Goursat, maybe 20 years before. This is just... And about Hamilton and Lagrange, of course, Hamilton was very, very, very patient reader of Lagrange, and he knew all the papers. Basically, he called Lagrange analytical mechanics a sort of scientific poem.
Yeah, but it does. I've not seen. You have a much more systematic reading of Hamilton than mine. But I don't think he ever quotes this 1808 paper in a very explicit form as a source of inspiration for him.
No, not for writing Hamilton.
What I have read is that Hamilton only after 4 or 5 years when he had written his optical papers, he discovered he could as well apply it to mechanics. So I have my doubts that Lagrange influenced him in his work.
Sure.
And when Lagrange writes that this process is very general and could be applied to any other kind of hypothesis about gravitation, what is he thinking about, another kind of homogeneous potential?
I think he really has in mind, I think, what Suryu finally established, that is namely for these differential equations, actually you always have a space of motion, with the difficulty that this space of motion may be non-separate, non-Hausdorff spaces, which is kind of embarrassing if you want to deal with them, but I think that's, he doesn't say more, so you see that's just a comment in the introduction, but clearly he had seen that the fact that you had ellipses was not so critical, although after that he uses that all the time, but so probably he had in mind that if you take other potential than 1 over r, then you would still, and of course you wouldn't have the same geometric very nice geometric figures. You would have things which maybe don't close up or...
Maybe a question about this. How do we know what space, what images Lagrange has in mind? What is your... it seems so difficult to...
Well, I mean, he stresses so much the element des planètes that for him, he really saw this as coordinates in something. So I think clearly he's always using this as a... He has a system depending on a certain number of parameters which can be used as coordinates to, because he, for example, discusses the fact that you can switch from invert something, so you have some kind of local diffeomorphism which allows you to change variables. So it seems that for him, I mean, these A, B, C, F, G, H are really parameterizing something. I mean, of course, he never calls it a space, because that's, I mean, language at that time was, I mean, you couldn't call this space, but... definitely, he does as if they have the same status as x, y, z, x prime, y prime, z prime. So completely equivalent status. So you're absolutely right. Maybe I'm over-imposing my own view on this. But still, technically, he really makes no difference between x, y, z, x prime, y prime, z prime, and a, b, c, f, g, h.